respected friend, if you ask me what is the purpose of this weekly gathering, then I say that it's to increase our love for the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He said in regards to Qari Tayyib Sahib Qasmi rahmatullahi alayhi, who was the principal of Darul Deoband, he would read 12,000 Durood Sharif a day. And today, students of knowledge like myself, people will come to us and say, Mawlana, in Salah, in the last rakat, can I read just half of Durood Sharif? Allahumma barik ala Muhammad, can I leave it out? You know, if I was to present to you the conclusion and of the hal and the way out of all the problems of the Muslim Ummah is to connect ourselves back to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. This is the hal of all of our mushkilat, is connecting ourselves to him. Because the Quran says, لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنًا. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he is a perfect example for you. So when it comes to politics, when it comes to being a father, being a leader, being a son, being a nephew. And I was, a friend of mine, his sister passed away at the age of 28 on Saturday. Mm. May Allah forgive her and grant her al-firdaus. Mm. And I was speaking to him and I said, look, you know, sometimes we don't realize that when we talk about the Messenger alayhi salam being an example, a leader in all aspects of our life, it also refers to how he dealt with musibah as well. And you'll never find such composure in any other man. In any other being. You won't find such perfection in every aspect of his life. So today we're going to look at the struggle of the Prophet ﷺ in delivering the message of Islam. And friends, you know, when you really think about it, you find that we received Iman because of the effort of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So now we hear about the story of Ta'if and many of the other sacrifices the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made. But it's because of these sacrifices Iman came to us. You know, we talk about converts and reverts, and there's always a debate, what word should you use more, convert or revert? And people get annoyed that, you know, what? Why are you playing on words? But just to annoy you a little more, the correct usage is convert. And there's an idea that people are born Muslim. And in Aqeedah, people aren't born Muslim. The correct understanding is people are not born Muslim. People are given something called fitrah. And ulama of Aqeedah have mentioned fitrah is the innate nature to acknowledge Allah. It's not Iman. It's the ability or the natural inclination towards Islam. So a person, he researches 10 different religions. But naturally, part of fitrah, a person will be inclined to Islam. So Islam, fitrah does not mean a person is born a Muslim. It means that Allah Ta'ala has created this ability in you to feel more inclined toward Islam. And this is all discussion on Aqeedah. Inshallah, in Jumu'ah this week, I'll be talking about the importance of Aqeedah and Tawheed. But that's why some of the scholars have said, for example, the Maturidi school of Aqeedah, that even if Islam doesn't reach an island, the inhabitants of the island still have to believe in one Allah. They have not heard of Islam, but they still have to believe in one God. Why? Because the signs of the world, where you look at the creation of the heavens and the earth. You know, I was in Keithley some time back, and I met a revert by the name of Ali. And he was brought up on a farm. And he said, my upbringing on a farm led me to Islam. And he said that I've been living in Keithley now for a couple of years and I want to go back to the farm. He said, looking at the stars on a night led me to Allah. Pondering over the creation of Allah on a farm led me to Allah. So just the creation of the heavens and the earth is sufficient to lead us to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But we came to know of Allah through the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That's why Mufti Shafi Uthmani rahimahullah in Jawahir al-Fiqh, he mentions that there's three main beliefs in Islam. Allah, Rasulullah, and the hereafter. And then he says, if you want to summarize them even further, he says, Islam revolves around Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. If you want to summarize Islam in one sentence, it's Muhammad Rasulullah, it's Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Because we only came to know of Allah through Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And we only came to know of Qiyamah through Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu narrates in the hadith of Bukhari, when the verse was revealed, وَأَنذِرْ عَشِيرَتَكَ الْأَقْرَبِينَ, and warn your closest kinsmen, was revealed, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam climbed Mount Safa and began to call out, O tribe of Fihr, O tribe of Adi, intending by it the people of Quraysh, until the people gathered. If a man was unable to come out, he would send someone on his behalf to see what it was about. Abu Lahab came, as did the Quraysh. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, tell me, if I were to inform you that an army is in the valley intending to invade you, would you believe me? They responded, yes, we have never experienced from you anything but the truth. He sallallahu alayhi wasallam replied, then I have come to you as a warner of a severe punishment that is before you. Abu Lahab, upon hearing this, said, may evil befall you forever. Is this why you have gathered us? Thereafter the verses were revealed, Tabbat yada Abi Lahabin wa tab. May the two hands of Abu Lahab perish. And may he perish, his wealth and what he earned did not avail him. My Shaykh, Hazrat Mawlana Ilyas Gumman Sahib Dam Barakatuhum, when commenting on this hadith, he mentions that before you convey the message of Islam to someone, it's important to affirm your standing within that community. It's important to gain the respect of that community. And this is a message he was giving to ulama, that before an alim, before a speaker, before a da'i in Tablighi Jamaat, he propagates Islam, he first needs to establish his khirdar. He first needs to establish his standing in the community. He first needs to establish his respect there. Because when they respect you, they will listen to you. And that's why from the du'as of the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, Allahumma ja'alni fi ayni saghira wa fi a'yunin nasi kabira. O Allah, make me respected in the eyes of people and allow me to consider myself insignificant in my own heart. Why? Because to convey the message of Islam, you need to be respected in that community. And you know, before sometimes an ulama would come, because alhamdulillah, I spent a lot of time in Tablighi Jamaat, so I used to think that, you know, a Mawlana comes and he introduces himself as Mawlana Abdul Latif Sahib. Sometimes an alim will prefix Mawlana or Sheikh to his name. And because of my upbringing in the noble effort of Dawud and Tabligh, may Allah spread its fuyud and benefit to other world, I should think Mawlana Sahib is not humble. But my Shaykh says that based on this hadith, to introduce yourself is part of the sunnah. So if a scholar was to introduce himself as Mawlana or Sheikh, there's no qabaha in it. Rather, he's following the sunnah. Because for a person to accept his words, they first need to know that this person is qualified in what he speaks. And the second thing is that some of the scholars have mentioned that this prophecy, that Abu Lahab, may the two hands of Abu Lahab perish, and may he perish, and it talks about him being in Jahannam. This proves that the Quran is the word of Allah. This surah is sufficient to prove that the Quran is the word of Allah subhanAllah. Why? Because when the Quran says that Abu Lahab is going to be in Jahannam, that's an indication that Abu Lahab is going to die without Iman. So the Quran is prophesizing Abu Lahab, regardless of how long he lives, he will never accept Islam. So what did Abu Lahab have to do to disprove Islam and the Quran? What did he have to do? Accept Islam. All he had to do was say the kalima once, and he could have disproved the Quran. But he didn't. And secondly, we know that when the Muslims conquered Makkah, the majority of people accepted Islam. Now, the thing is, if Abu Lahab was alive at that time, he would have also accepted Islam. But historians tell us that he died 6 years before the conquest of Makkah. So the Quran is prophesizing that Abu Lahab, in essence, indirectly, will pass away before the conquest of Makkah, and he will never receive the gift of Iman. Now, when we look at some of the other false claimants of Nubuwa, like Mirza Ghulam Qadiani, where he prophesies that I'm going to marry Muhammadi Begum, and he never married her, and then he said her husband will die within 2 years, and he lived for another 30 years. So the way to tell a person is a false claimant of Nubuwa is by his prophecies. So when the Quran makes a claim that Abu Lahab is going to be in Jahannam, which is essence saying he'll never become a Muslim, and he died on kufr, this is an indication and a proof itself that the word of Quran is the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allahu Akbar. But we finish on this, that what do we learn from this hadith? That one can imagine the pain that these words caused the blessed heart of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Why? Because it was the kith and kin, Abu Lahab, who used foul words towards the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And all of us would have experienced this, that someone outside, if they're nasty to you, they're harsh to you, to some extent you bear it. But go home and the wife nags you and you fall into rage. Why? Because it's someone from home. There was one scholar, he was working and he's been persecuted. And people were throwing stones, small pebbles. He didn't make a sound. And another scholar, he threw you know, a plant at him, you know, a small portion of the plant. And he made a sound. Ah. So the sheikh asked him, who threw the portion of the plant, that people were throwing pebbles at you, you never made a noise. When I threw a portion of the plant at you, you made ah sound. He said, they've not recognized my status whilst you have. Even after recognizing me, you threw some at me. So this was the situation where Abu Lahab, despite being related to the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he still had the audacity to say words which caused discomfort to the heart of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And because of that, Allah Ta'ala revealed Surah Lahab. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us the love of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. وآخر دعوانا الحمد لله رب العالمين سبحان الله وبحمده سبحان الحمد لله لا إله إلا أنت